No board members present on Zoom. If there are any members of the public present on Zoom, please identify yourself.
Jennifer Curley, City of Houston.
Thank you, Jennifer. Anybody else?
Margaret Dunlap, Senior Public Affairs with Metro.
Thank you. Okay, for Zoom participants, please say your name before speaking, and please keep yourself on mute if you are not. First order of business is to approve the minutes from the January 24, 2024 meeting. Could I have a motion to approve the minutes, please?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye, it is approved. Okay. We'll suspend reinvestment zone number 16, City of Houston meeting, and we will call to order the Uptown Development Authority meeting. Again, I don't think we have any board members on Zoom. Members of the public, if you would, please identify yourselves.
Jennifer Curley, City of Houston.
Jennifer?
Margaret Dunlap with Metro.
Thank you, Margaret. Okay. Same rules about keeping on mute if you don't mind. We don't have any comments or questions from the public. Our first order of business is to approve the minutes of the January 24, 2024 meeting. If I could have a motion, please. Second? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Now we'll turn it over to Shannon. We have some invoices to review and approve.
Okay, great. Thank you. On page four, we have invoices that we're presenting for your approval. The top section are reimbursements to the Harris County Improvement District Number 1 for admin and project management for 2 months. That would be February and March, to the tune of just over $128,000. And then in the center, we have just over $113,000 worth of invoices for the UDA contracts with our legal provider, as well as our construction management vendors or consultants, and water wall maintenance. All in all, $241,773.07. And then lastly, our contract payments, which are approved by agreement. We have a small pay application to Harper Brothers for the Wilson's Gully project to the tune of $62,415. And the fifth of 8 payments to Memorial Park Conservancy for the maintenance of the prairie. That was all included in the original land bridge project. Total for all contracts and construction projects, $421,307.
Okay. Are there any questions? No. There are no questions. Could I have a motion to approve this?
I make a motion to approve.
Second. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, we will stay with Shannon for the MWBE report, please.
Great, thank you. On page 7, we have the summary for this reporting period. At the top, we look at the results on a cumulative basis. So you see that overall, 41% with a 24% goal for professional services. And as far as our construction goal of 17%, cumulative year, we've inception to date, we are at 24%. The bottom half of the summary page just looks at the current fiscal year, 52% for professional services and 61% for construction. And currently we just have the Wilson's Gully project under construction. And Karami, which did the pipes materials, Robert, is a DBE. And so you see that to date, that's a large portion of the DBE. We also have, following up, just a little bit of detail about the prime and the subs. You can see what we spent here today, and a few graphical depictions of the percentage participation over the fiscal year. As for your information, are there questions or concerns regarding the DBE?
We have
Now we'll go to get a proposed amendment to the tax exempt note purchase agreement. Stephen and Jessica.
Go ahead, Jessica.
Good to see you all again. In 2022, you all entered into a note purchase agreement with Regions Bank that allows one-year notes on an as-needed basis. Those notes are variable rate, and they were indexed to the, I think, my sheet, BSBY, the Bloomberg short-term bank yield. And that rate, or that index, is disappearing as of November of 2024. So we need to amend your note purchase agreement with a replacement rate. They've asked us to use the secured overnight financing rate administered by the Federal Reserve. The factoring remains the same, so it will be that rate plus times a multiplier of 79.79% plus 7.71 basis points. We've issued three notes, and today we'll be asking you to issue a fourth note. This fourth note will use the new index rate. Is there any questions?
Is that the best rate to pick, and is everyone using that rate? How's it?
Yes.
How does it measure up as a rate to use?
I'm though your lowly bond counsel, I have talked to your financial advisor, and she did advise that is this index is what is being used to replace this.
Effectively, what happened is there were competitors. BSB and SOFR were two competing index types, and it turns out that BSB was the one that kind of fell by the wayside. It was like Betamax versus VHS, and BSB became a Betamax, and SOFR is what learned. It really is kind of all there.
You missed so much of your audience with that.
I would go with cassette tapes and CDs.
Okay.
Something like that. Kristen, your financial advisor, I asked her, and she said she really didn't think that, yet as you continue to issue notes, your rates will really be all that different as this be happened.
It almost doesn't matter because it is the only index. I mean, this all replaced LIBOR.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, remember LIBOR? Well, it went by the wayside. And these were going to be the two replacements, but one of them went out.
So they don't have any competition, huh?
No. But it's still a good rate.
It's administered.
I mean, it's your short-term
reserve.
Overnight rate.
Yeah.
So what do we need to do?
The motion would be to approve the First Amendment to your tax exempt note purchase agreement.
Okay, is that on a particular?
Yes.
That is item 7.
On page 13 of your book.
Didn't work. Maybe that was the problem. Okay, are there any other questions? Someone like to make a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jessica. Okay, we have some projects to approve.
Project updates.
Update, rather?
Yeah. Dave Clark is going to give us an update on the Uptown Memorial Trail and Bridge project and a couple other projects.
Great. All right. Thank you. You can see from this drawing, this is coming up alongside the West Loop coming from Buffalo Bayou, and I'll show you where that's originating in the next slide. So that would have been originating from going underneath the West Loop and coming up by the Arboretum. We start on the far left. Basically a post oak hotel along Hollyhurst, and that's really just, let's make sure that it's a nice place to walk and go up to the intersection where the two bus stations are right now at Uptown Park Boulevard. Then we connect along this post oak park with a trail that ties into a trail along Uptown Park Shops all the way up to the Buffalo Bayou with a bridge over Buffalo Bayou, underneath the West Loop, and then along the Arboretum and Memorial Park up to Memorial Drive. It's 1.9 miles. We did receive an $18.6 million grant from the Federal Transit Administration. It was part of TxDOT's Transportation Alternatives call. TxDOT was more generous than the whole United States in making sure that there's funding available for these kinds of projects last year. We also received a $4 million earmark from U.S. Representative Wesley Hunt. Together, that gives us a $22.6 million are going to stay within that budget so that we don't have to draw down from our bank account to pay for this project.
And so we're starting, I just want to say, we're starting it in the district, and we're going to be moving it to the UDA, because it's easier to work with FDA and a lot of deals going through the UDA than it is the district. Is that?
So you'll be here for construction. You'll see our progress with design, but we'll be coming back to you to oversee the construction.
So there's no actions today by the UDA or the TIRZ.
That's right.
There will be a later date.
Yeah, we did have action just before this meeting, where they selected the grant administrator, the engineer, and architect, and we'll be coming back for the construction manager at risk. And in a year from now, we'll have the final designs and then a final construction cost, and then 18 months after that, December of 2026, would be our goal date to perhaps substantial completion of this project.
Hey, before we go to another, Lisa, you got a question?
I've never heard that term, select construction manager at risk. I don't know, that's a new word for me.
Sure. Steve Dunn will be our project manager who provided oversight for Uptown when we did the boulevard and for the land bridge. But I'll use land bridge as an example. There was a competition between construction companies to oversee the cost estimating and procurement of the subcontractors, and gave us a guaranteed price before they even started construction. That's how that project stayed under budget the whole way through. We anticipate that's a good way for us to keep our landscape architect and engineers in touch with the real reality of what costs are right now in Houston, Texas, by having a local construction company working with them through the design process, but then giving us a guaranteed price at the end of the design process that they're at risk, that they're going to have to complete the project for the guaranteed price they give us in May of 2025, next year.
Is that good? Is that right?
So,
thank you.
Steve Dunn, he works for us, or he works for Thompson? Or?
Steve Dunn works for us.
He works for us.
Yes.
Okay. So
Benny? Go ahead, I'm sorry.
I was just going to say, he's going to be ensuring that the, will be our construction manager at risk?
No.
He's our project manager.
I would call him, he's the owner's representative.
Yeah.
That's what a lot of people would call it. He works for us.
Right. He makes sure that everything goes as smoothly and that we did it at the cost that we projected. He did the land bridge. Yeah, and also the boulevard. So he's got a lot of experience.
And we employ the construction manager at risk on the land bridge as well. Yeah.
And he knows all the different players from Memorial Park, the Arboretum, TxDOT, us, et cetera. I want to note one thing is that this is under 610 right now, this rendering is.
Mm-hmm.
And so TxDOT, they have significant damage under 610 from Harvey that they never fixed. They are letting us do the project work and fix it and hire the contractors and do it with them. They'll be watching what we're doing. But TxDOT usually don't let anybody do any of their project, but they're letting us because of the job the Uptown team, Steve Dunn and others, have done on the other projects. So this could run into a significant increase, but if it does, TxDOT's paying for it.
And that's because of the damage already existing?
The damage already existing. They have to do it. But instead of them doing it, they want us to do it. One of the things is because Steve Dunn and us, we get along with the Arboretum and the park, and if we have to cut down a tree, it's us working with the park that tree has to be removed. And it's a bigger deal if TxDOT has to remove the tree.
So you got a contract, I mean, everything's in writing, right? TxDOT?
We're getting it in writing. This is the process.
Oh, okay.
We've had a number of meetings with TxDOT. They want us to do it. We'll have another agreement with TxDOT coming up.
Shoots, then we can't blame them for stuff. That's
We can still do that.
Yeah.
Okay.
So Steve Dunn is working for us as the project administrator. The district's board just approved SWA Group being our landscape architect and Consor Engineers being our engineer. and they approved the grants administration to be provided by Goodman Corporation. And as we've been talking, the construction manager at risk will make that decision in May. That's coming up. We have a call for proposals right now.
And for those of you who haven't seen it, this will come up at the Villa de Estes, is right there, and you'll come around Memorial, you'll come over Buffalo Bayou. This is the archery range on the west side of 610. It'll loop back around. We're also going to try to figure out how we come up with a couple more dollars to actually do a little more trails inside the archery range.
And we went through a very competitive selection process, and to select the landscape architect and the engineer, as well as the grant administrator. What we discovered was there's a relationship that's now going to be created between the landscape architect and the engineer. We'll have separate contracts with each one so we can control each. And the benefit of SWA and Consor working together on this is they have had experience designing the bridge and trail over Buffalo Bayou on the Welcome Wilson Jr. Trail that goes from San Felipe to, now it goes not quite up to Buffalo Bayou. The plan is to continue over Buffalo Bayou. They also are familiar with all the stakeholders that they've been working with and how to work in Buffalo Bayou itself, and getting permits from United States Army Corps of Engineers and the NEPA registration. NEPA requirements require the EPA for our wetlands and for our wildlife park area. And SWA has designed Buffalo Bayou Park from Shepherd to downtown. They're also working with the designer for the Buffalo Bayou Park East sector. They've designed three bridges on Buffalo Bayou Park and other bridge projects we'll show you in another slide. Consor has over 50 miles of trails and 20 different bridges that they have built in Houston that are pedestrian and bicycle oriented. And they, TxDOT was very happy that we selected Consor because they will be working underneath the bridges on Buffalo Bayou, and they have a good relationship with TxDOT as well as Flood Control District, the city, and the Federal Transit Administration.
Do we do any bulkheading or things to help with erosion?
They call it riprap. Think of it as big concrete embankments that they normally design. They're going to let us actually put a trail through that and design that bulkhead.
That's the boulders, right?
This is like riprap.
Yeah.
But so how far in will that, I guess it only goes?
It'll only be in the TxDOT right of way.
Oh, okay. So it'll continue to have the erosion it's got now. Buffalo Bayou, as you go.
Right. And coming to the bayou coming to the bridge as well as going away from the bridge.
I guess it contributes to the color of the water.
Yeah. One thing about
the core engineer's thing.
One thing good about is it SWA that worked with Villa de Esta?
Yeah, that'd be great. Yeah, they did the waterfront park there.
Right in front of them.
Any of the firms selected or being selected, are any of them minority owned?
They are not minority owned, but they all provided their team of minority participants. That would be, we have a 12.9% low threshold from the FTA. We have our higher uptown threshold that we'll be negotiating with the consultants next week to make sure we build a team that meets our higher consultant requirements.
And this is, they're responsible for about 15% of the overall budget, which is around $3 million. Once we bring somebody on to actually build it, they're not gonna build it. They're gonna come up with the design and the engineering. We'll bring somebody else on to build it. We'll go through another negotiation, make sure we meet those FWA vehicles, and then whoever builds it.
And that'll be part of the selection at construction manager at risk to make sure the team that they're proposing will provide that. The bridges that SWA has built in Houston, the one on the top left is at Mason Park, going over Brays Bayous, really activated that park, connecting both sides. The one on the top right, that's the Montrose bridge. They call it Rosemont, but it's next to Montrose going over Buffalo Bayou. The Ismaili Center's being constructed on the other side of Allen Parkway. The bottom left is a bridge. It's sort of in the middle between Studemont and Sabine Street, helping reduce the length of loops, and that's going to the police memorial on Buffalo Bayou. And then the bottom right is the Jackson Hill Bridge, about where the Dunleavy area is, crossing Buffalo Bile. I'll give you a quick update on where we are in our construction, and Lewis, that you were asking.
And again, the Hidalgo and Martin DeProver Park, those are both district parks, but we thought we'd give you an update.
Yeah, I think we care a lot about these two parks. This is detention, was a detention facility for the West Loop. Now different drainage is occurring, so it's not necessary so much for the highway detention. So we're making a park out of it. Jerdon is our contractor, and we anticipate substantial completion in May. The drawing on the right shows what we were hoping this walkway would look like on the edge of the pond, and on the left is really the excellent concrete work that's been happening and the scoring for that.
And good to know the fish and the ducks that have been living there through the construction, they're still there.
Well, I think it's amazing. The fountain, go back again if you can, but the fountain that's going to be turned on has been moved, and it was quite an exercise to move that fountain with cranes to get it from the south side of the pond up to the north side. And from the illustration on the right shows the arches at the street level, the giant planter at the base that's was under construction, the drawing on the left, or photo on the left. And then we have concrete steps that we call the cypress steps that bring you down to that plaza level of the walkway along the pond.
And TxDOT's going to come in after us and put trees all along the 610, that bank over there.
DeProver Park, the permitting was delayed on that, and the construction started later than the other parks, so they'll both be on the same schedule. Jerdon is building both of these parks, and we have substantial completion in May. And today, if you go into the park, what you'll see are the foundations for there's a wall that's going to be built on top of this foundation.
It's being built.
Oh, yeah, that's
see it.
Yeah. And so that wall will be, they're building the wall this week. Yeah.
It's halfway up.
Yeah, so the wall's on top of that foundation, and that wall will have the story of Uptown on it, and the members of the TIRZ and the UDA, as well as members of the management district ever since the creation of the management district. So it's like an icon for the park, for Uptown too. This is a very large sheet. It's like the size of a sheet of plywood that we use for our test sample of stainless steel. It's a number 3 finish with a polished edge, a little mirror edge, as we call a little bling on it. Middle shot is just the same, just on an angle. Top right, we're going through exercises for the different lighting to make sure all the lumens will be matching up on that structure. And then the bottom, bottom of the right is the 18-foot tall tower that will be clad with the stainless steel and the lighting.
Update on Wilson's Gully, which is a UDA TIRZ project.
Yeah, if you remember, it's to connect boxes under Four Oaks with boxes under Eden property at Uptown Park Boulevard, $6.7 million. Good news is we've got that less than $700,000 in the bank. We have all the funds. This area built it. We're building it from the north and south in the second phase, which is the extra pipe. The first pipe has been lined and is completed. So this is running back into from the north end, or you can see 4L to the back. But the pipe is the new pipe is 26 feet to the bottom of this hole. It is completed now to a crossover box that I'll show you in the next slide. This is the crossover box. This is the existing 120-inch pipe that has been lined. We're coming in from one side with a new pipe that we had to put on that side because how you connect to the existing. We're going to cross it over here and head out this way to go south to the end of Inverness property in the corner with Camden. And then through Camden to the alley between Four Oaks and Camden to connect this all.
That's a complex. It's a complex project.
This is the hardest little piece to build, and the production rate should increase as we go forward here in the next few nuts and get the pipe all the way to the four oaks.
There was significant flooding, if I remember, with Harvey on that side of uptown.
Postal plane at the Sam Fleet, we always flooded. This is part of the restriction that caused that flooding, and we can relieve it. We can't cure it, but we can relieve it for most of the rains that happen, because we doubled the conveyance of water between the two points. Answer any questions?
Thank you, Rob. Appreciate it. The some updates on projects and operation things we're doing. We've re-signed a lease for tenure to be here. They have the option to move us 12th floor and up, so they might. They've got one tenant they're looking at possibly moving here that wants three floors. If that tenant comes in, they'll move us higher probably. We'll still have this bulldoze. We'll still have a conference room. Yeah, and then if they do, they have to pay for all the wiring for all our cameras and everything. But we're happy with it. We got a good deal.
Who owns this building?
Midway Parkway. We're excited about staying here. We got a good deal. Some other updates, public safety. Uptown is a safe place. We have some issues with some car break-ins, but it's a safe place to live, work, play, shop. We have put in Congressman Wesley Hunt got us that earmark for the bridge. We have an earmark request, $3 million earmark request for uptown pedestrian safety improvements that were put in through Congresswoman Lizzie Fletcher. We're hoping we get it. We don't know if we can, but we have significant street corners. A lot of people, more and more people every day are walking across the streets, walking their dogs. You can see it up and down the boulevard. It's great. At the same time, we have to make sure everybody's safe crossing the street. We have some long expansions, especially up there at West Time. We did have a pedestrian fatality this morning at 7:30 at Sage and West Time. We don't know all the details. Somebody was trying to cross the street. I think they might have run out in front of a truck and got hit. We also have an issue under, there's one spot under West Alabama the gallery, when you go over that crosswalk,
yes.
That's down. It's been down for years. This will help fix that. And it's expensive. It's not cheap. It's like over $50,000 just to fix that one lighting. It might be $75,000. So this will go for pedestrian safety improvements on all our intersections. We hope we get it. We've had a number of meetings at this beginning of the year. We've met with HPD command staff. We met with Chief Finninger, his command staff, Bob and TJ. Have been helping set these things up, meetings up. We've met with the local commander of Midwest Division. We met with his team. We've asked with council member Huffman and her team, both on homelessness issues and on public safety. And we can't have a better council member to represent us at City Hall and council member Huffman. We've met with the DRT teams. Those are the teams that help with homelessness issues. There are other areas of Houston that have bigger homelessness issues, but we do have some. And so we need to help those people find a better place to either shelter or housing, but not living on the streets. We met with the Galleria, Dillard's, Uptown Park, and others. We have started a monthly meeting with the Midwest Division that we're meeting on public safety issues. The big issues right now is car break-ins. They're going down. They really are. They're going down. They've seen it at the Galleria. They've seen it at other areas going down. But we still have to get ahead of it. The Galleria is making upgrades to their parking lots and their entrances. Dillard's is closing off their parking lot after hours or putting chains. They're having a security go around it, which they didn't have before. Uptown Park's doing some things. Our patrols are being more diligent going around in parking lots and looking for signs of people breaking in cars. But
is that what the decrease is attributed to, these extra efforts? Or?
I think some of it is just natural from what happened after the pandemic. Crime all around the country went up. Now it's going down. But I think some of our efforts are, it's hard to say. You got to try your hardest, you got to do everything you can, and you have some impact.
In your car.
I would say yes. Yeah, do not leave your. So many people leave their backpack, their computer in the car, and it's sitting right there, you can see it. They don't even hide.
I was gonna ask a question, I'm aware of a couple of incidents in the park where there was sense of vandalism, when the fence broke, but there was nothing in the park for someone. So I just wonder how much of the break-ins or
For fun?
Theft for later, or just people having the time to break in.
Yeah, but you also have to do a break-in, and looking in the car, not seeing, not getting anything.
Not seeing what they want, yeah.
And there are some that are more sophisticated, that with meeting with HPD, the flock camera guys and others, is that there are others that they'll have a guy on a radio, on a cell phone, and he'll walk by cars and go, a red BMW, Ford F-150. And then you have the other ones that are not sophisticated, that break the window and look inside. So they have a, there's different, again, uptown is safe, one of the safest areas in the entire city, and car break-ins have been going down. We want to keep on that, on a daily, weekly, monthly basis. I think we're seeing some, but we just can't tell you, it's us. But TJ and his team, and Bob and Dwayne, have been working on a daily basis. Again, we have started, since we meet with Commander Becker, the police chief, we're starting a regular meeting, with a monthly meeting with the Galleria, Dillard's, Uptown Park's gonna join us, others who have property here are welcome to join. It's basically a monthly meeting, sharing stories, how we do a better job of coordinating, in this area, on public safety issues, whether they're pedestrian safety or whether, something like a car break-in. Met with Councilmember Huffman twice, one on homelessness issues and one on public safety. She's been a great partner. She's invested in overtime, she's gonna invest in overtime again. Our security.
What does that mean, invest in overtime?
She invested at the end of the year $90,000 and for the DRT teams to come through here. They're gonna continue to do that. I don't know how much it is, but they said that there was still some left over at the beginning of the year, so they're using that up. And then, it's time to have another conversation, she's gonna put some more. She might be waiting for the next budget cycle. The, Panhandlers and homeless, thanks to TJ, our officers, our patrols didn't have, usually you had to have an HPD card to have a citation book in your car. We've talked to the police chief and the commander, and we've signed out, citation books. We have citation books in our trucks, and we do give tickets. If somebody's panhandling in the middle of the street, you can't give anybody a citation for panhandling on the street, in the median, but if they step out in a city street, you can. We have been doing that. There are professional panhandlers that come here from other parks because we're a high-traffic area, and they get a citation. If they don't pay it, they get a warrant. They don't want that. They might go somewhere else. So we're dealing with homeless. We've met with the Coalition of the Homeless. There is an issue of homelessness in the city of Houston. We need to help them find someplace to live and find help. And we're cognizant of that, but at the same time, we have retailers. And Dillard's has had an issue recently, and they said at the last meeting when we met the HPD that a number of the homeless that have been around Dillard's have left. And so we don't know where they went. We don't know if they found help or not, but they're not. They were an issue over there.
They still have those three-wheeled motorcycles, I don't know what you call them, that go down the road.
I haven't seen that in quite a while.
In Westheimer, well, I know that, I saw them in the River Oaks area, and then they're further out. You know where they race up and down?
Not lately. There used to be street takeovers, where they take over an intersection and they'd spin out the cars and stuff. They passed a law in the legislature that, if you do a street over and HPD or a law enforcement captures you, you lose your car. You can lose your car. They've moved to parking lots. Dillard's did have one a number of weeks ago. Dillard's is putting chains up around all their entrances and exits the other night. Talking to HPD, most of them are kids that have, are young adults that invest a lot in their cars, and they like to go out Friday and Saturday night, and they like to spend. They're not. And
what do you call them?
And the worst thing, the car meetups, they're
No, but what do you call the vehicle itself?
There's three-wheelers or four-wheelers that pop up.
Yeah, and they love to go down the street on one wheel with.
We don't. That's really dangerous, obviously. But the ones that are doing the street takeovers, they don't want their car taken. They have jobs, they invest all their money in their car, and most of them are just out to have a good Friday and Saturday night. And they meet, they follow each other on TikTok or Instagram. And so we haven't seen that a lot. We have seen TIRZ did in their parking lot. They're taking some steps to stop that from people coming in their parking lot after hours. Hidalgo exit at I-610 is dangerous when you're coming off. I don't know if anybody's ever taken that before. You take it, it's a sharp right turn, and if you don't watch out, you're hitting that wall. We've talked to TxDOT about it, about putting up signage, finishing out the wall, moving some signs they've got that kind of distract drivers. They're going to work with us on changing it and add it to part of their project. We've got a big employer moving in at the end of the year, Lyondell Basalt, into the tower, and we want them to, and it's right there by them. We want to make sure they don't have issues when they move in and stuff, but it's a safety issue. TxDOT is going to help us with that. One other issue is not on here. We have a TIRZ budget coming up. Basically, you've seen the budget before. It's not going to change much from last year. Shannon, we're going to bring it to you. We'll send it to you before the next meeting. We need to take a vote on it. Next meeting doesn't mean it won't change, but we need to, at the schedule is to get it to the city in April, end of April. We'll go back and forth on it, and then there'll be a final vote sometime in June by the city on it. So we'll send it to you well ahead of time so you can take a look at it, ask the right questions. We'll sit down with Steve and take a look at it before then, see if he has any questions. We'll compare it to the year before, and be ready to roll. Last one, Metro's on the phone. Metro is going from the Silver Line 4 stops an hour to 3 stops an hour. Margaret, did I get that right?
Yeah, 20 minutes.
Every 20 minutes? Metro was on the line earlier. It's because of the ridership. I've requested a meeting with them about talking how they feed the line better. I don't think it justifies more than 3 an hour right now with the number of ridership. It'd be nice if they went more often, but right now. But we do need to have conversations about how they feed the Silver Line from more southeast west. How many people would take a direct bus from Sugar Land up to the transit center, get off, get on the bus, and come here? There are a number of people that live out 290 in Al Katy that come and work around here. So how do we work with them about getting more direct service to the Silver Line so we increase ridership on them? Of course, they have other plans. We got a new mayor. He has new issues that he's going to deal with his team with Metro. So we're going to work with Metro on how we actually get more ridership on the Silver Line.
That's the biggest criticism I've heard.
It was a boulevard project that included a bus line. And the bus line, correct me if I'm wrong, anybody, it was all federal and state dollars that built the bus line.
Mm-hmm.
And the TIRZ dollars, the city dollars, built the boulevard. When I was a kid growing up around here, I'd ride my bike down Post Oak Boulevard, and a bus would be flying next to me, next to the sidewalk. It is a gorgeous, beautiful boulevard with buses in the middle. And if I was somebody walking their dog, going to Whole Foods or going to a restaurant, I can walk by down that street without having a bus flying by me. And so here's what. A couple more, economic development. I was driving home with my kids from spring break, and I started yelling at, there's a crane. We don't have any cranes up in Houston. We do have one south. There's a apartment complex going up on McHugh, 172 unit luxury apartment, 7 story, to the south, down the south side, McHugh off of Richmond. That'll be finished in 2025. Last meeting, we talked about some of the economic drivers. Uptown is an economic engine for the city. We're going to go through all the different numbers. At the end of the year, we'll put them in a book, and we want to tell our story that the Uptown District and the Uptown TIRZ have been a success and what they were originally designed to do. Here's one, this is the one I talked about last week, the hot tax of the city. Over the last 10 years, Uptown has represented 18% of the total hotel occupancy tax that goes to the city. For comparison, downtown is 20% of the 10-year period. Medical center, 9, airport, 9. This also is, takes into account that the city downtown built two big convention center hotels and has all the convention. On the retail side, I wish Irma Castro, who's with the district, was here, who's the manager over at the Galleria. As Bob likes to tell, if I put these numbers, the retail has been kicking it in Uptown. We only have total 22 numbers because the state lags in sending us the retail numbers for 23. We only have the first two quarters in 23. But in 2022, $5.6 billion in retail dollars was spent in the Uptown area. Compared to the Central Business District was $2 billion, Memorial City Center, $1.2 billion, Kirby and Uptown, Kirby and Rice Village. Threw Rice Village in just for comparison. But those are huge numbers in retail sales. Now, what does that mean to the city? These are the tax dollars that actually come from those sales. This is City of Houston tax dollars, and this is Metro tax dollars combined. $49 million in 2022 from retail in the Uptown area. There's a lot of buildings that have been built on the other side of 610 that would not be built without Uptown doing what it did. These are big numbers compared to downtown 12 million in tax revenue. Memorial City Center, or double them, 21 million. So we're going to build a story on how what the history of Uptown has been and what is an economic engine for the city. We're looking at valuations. When the district was formed, the valuation for was the district of TIRZ, $1.9 billion in property value. Now it is $7.4 billion in property value for the properties within inside the district. If you take 30 minutes and you look at what has happened in the last 10 years on the other side of 610, there's over $2 billion. And Bob looked up, there's been $10 billion and capital $4 billion in capital investment in the last 10 years in this area. That's a lot of money and a lot of development. So we're going to build the story on the investment by the city and the TIRZ, the investment by the property owners in the district has been, it's been a success. We're going to go through those property value numbers. We also have all the money that we've invested in affordable housing around the city that's come from this district, and we're proud of that fact. I think that's it. Did I miss anything, Shannon, Bob, anybody?
So that River Oaks district and Highland Village aren't even.
They're actually in. They're actually in the Uptown area. They're not in the district and they're not in the TIRZ. But as far as when you look at when CoStar, you know who CoStar is? When CoStar looks at an area, they combine them together because that wouldn't be built if it wasn't for here with all the investment.
These retail numbers, do they include River Oaks?
Yes, they do. Yes, they do.
We just don't get their packages.
Yeah, they get it for free.
Yeah. Exactly. It's like Tillman's development over here is in 77027 while we're 77056. They're.
No, but he had to join. Yes. That's because we assisted with the road.
Right.
So he did the right thing.
I did. So there's going to be some changes, by understanding, to Memorial Park. Commissioner Briones, you talk about Commissioner Briones. Yeah, I was going to talk to y'all separately because y'all are on the y'all are on the other committee.
Okay. Do we have any more? I think we've concluded our business.
We're here unless anybody has questions.
Yeah. Any questions? Comments? Anything?
Thank you.
Okay. We will recess Uptown Development Authority meeting. We will reconvene the TIRZ meeting and we will adjourn.
Thank God.
Number 16, Uptown Development.
Is that a meeting?
Thank you very much, everybody.